It's great to come to this stage of life and know that others have been keeping up in the race. When you serve the Lord for as long as we have, there are many people that you know that have fallen by the wayside. But to see those who are still going on and doing a great work for God lets me know that we can make it. And our brother just spoke a few moments ago about passing on our message to another generation. Very stirring message, and I want to thank you for that. Praise God. Praise God. Well, I feel the presence of the Lord here, and I realize I'm probably the third or so speaker. And so that has its challenges as well. Some of you have been sitting, so maybe I'm going to have you stand as we turn to the scriptures this morning. Okay, I've got all my scriptures written out, and I have them in my case. I was in the couple of the summit meetings that we had in November in Malaysia. We had a summit meeting there for Eastern religions, a Chinese summit, an Indian summit, and during one of the sessions I was asked to give a devotional. And so I gave a message, and with apologies to Brother and Sister Bodegas and Brother Buckland, I do feel very strongly to preach this message this morning, or teach this message. It's a message that the Lord burned into my heart as a young minister. After leaving Bible college, I pastored in the city of Toronto. Brother and Sister Heard are here. They took care of the church after we left. And so I guess I've got everything coming full cycle here. Old Bible school students, pastors that took our church and so on. But in the early years that I was pastoring in Canada, especially the first year, the Lord led me to do a lot of fasting and praying. I would pray every day between 2 and 8 hours. And that first year I fasted for, if you totaled the time together, about 5 months out of the 12 months. I felt like I needed to get a foundation in my ministry and an understanding of what God wanted to do. And through that, the Lord gave me revelation of some things in the spirit world. And it's been something that I've been able to use. I used it in Canada, I used it in Pakistan, and it works. At this point, it's no longer theory. It's something that I've actually put into practice, and I know that it works. And so I want to try and share some things with you. This is probably the heart of my ministry. If there's anything else that I've done, maybe it's sort of on the edges. But this is what drives me in my walk with God and with my ministry. And I'd like to share it with you this morning. We're going to turn in our Bibles to the book of Ephesians chapter 1. I did speak this, as I mentioned, in the summit in Malaysia, but they had devotionals for 30 minutes. I've got a little longer now, so I can elaborate a little bit. I don't want to wear you out. My job is not to wear out the saints of the Most High. I want to try and encourage you and give you something. And let me say this. I understand in a crowd this size, not everybody's going to really listen. Not everybody's going to really take what I'm giving. But if I can give even one person in this crowd to understand what I'm saying and take it and use it, it's going to impact a lot of people.
Yes.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Ephesians chapter 1, beginning at verse 16, Paul said, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your presence that's in this place here this morning. You've come to meet with your people, and your presence has settled in here like a cloud. And now we ask for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We ask, Lord, that you would minister to each one. Give us open hearts to receive. Give us a spirit of revelation and understanding that we might understand the full power and authority that you've invested in the church. And we ask these things in the name which is above every name. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you give him glory one time more time before you sleep? God has given to the church a very powerful spiritual authority. I would say probably 95% of believers don't really know anything about it. But to the 5% that have taken hold of it, they have helped to change their world. Today I want to give you access to some things that if you can grab a hold of them, can change not only your city, your nation, this continent, but even the world. I believe that the Lord, when he sent his church into the world, sent it forth equipped. He didn't send it out just to go and preach and say, well, I hope things work out for the best. But I believe that he sent his church and he equipped them. There is nothing that we need to fear. There is nothing that can stop us if we will go in the power of his might. If we'll go in his spirit, taking the blood of Jesus, the word of God, we can go with confidence and knowing that he is with us and will give us victory. Paul said to the church at Ephesus, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. He said, I appreciate your stand that you have made, and I pray for you every day. This is what my prayer is, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom. Yesterday I talked about tuning our ears to hear what God has to say. And he said, what I am praying is that God will give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. I want you to understand who he is and what he represents and how we can use that knowledge to great effect. I want you to know him in his power and in his resurrection. I want you to know him with full knowledge and understanding, not just as one in passing. When I was a young man, I heard the Prime Minister of Canada was going to be in a certain place, and so I thought, well, I'll go and listen to him give his speech. And I went and heard him, and afterwards I shook his hand and made a comment or two. But other than what I read in the newspaper, I really didn't know much about him. There are a lot of believers that just have passing knowledge of who Jesus is. Even though they had an experience with him, they don't really know him. But I believe that it is the desire of God and the will of God for us to know Him through wisdom and revelation, that we can understand the power that He has and the knowledge He wants to impart to us. He said, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you might know what is the hope of His calling. He's got some hopes for us, just as parents have hopes for their children. God has hopes for us. He wants us to understand what those hopes are. He wants us to understand the things that He has prepared for us, the things that He has in store for us to use. He wants our understanding opened to that. He wants it to be enlightened, that we may know what is the hope of His calling and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints are. There are so many believers walk around defeated. They're walking around as though the devil's beating them up. I heard a lady give a testimony one time. Oh, the devil's been after me all week, bless His holy name. And that's about the way that some people serve the Lord. They think about the devil all the time. But I'm glad to say we serve one who's far greater than the enemy. Praise God. He is all powerful, and if we can understand what He has given to us, we can live in victory no matter what is happening around us. In verse 20, or verse 19, He said, and what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe? God has given us not just power, He has not just given us great power, but exceeding great power. Paul used superlatives when he described the activity of God and what He has prepared for us. And so He said here that He has given us exceeding greatness in power to us for who believe, according to the working of His mighty power. There are people in the world who are turning to spiritism and witchcraft looking for power. But if you want power, the greatest power comes from the Creator, the one who brought into existence the worlds. And I want to receive His power, which is readily available if we will receive it. It's open there for us. And He said in verse 20, which He wrought in Christ. First of all, it happened in Jesus when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in the heavenly places. In the Bible, when they talk about right hand, it's talking about the hand of power and authority. And Jesus was set at the hand of power in heavenly places. When you're in heavenly places, you are above things on the earth. Your perspective changes. When you have to look up, you feel a little bit intimidated. But when you're up above looking down, you're in a position of authority and power. You're in a position of intimidation. God has given you the victory, and so Jesus sat in a place of power in heavenly places. And I love this in verse 21. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. When Jesus rose after His resurrection and ascended into heaven, He sat at a place of power in the heavenly places, far above all principality. It didn't matter the most powerful person living in the earth who it was. It didn't matter the most mighty army that there was on the earth. It didn't matter who had the greatest wealth on the earth. He sits far above all principalities and powers and might. They are so far beneath him that with the human eye we probably couldn't even see them because of his position of power and authority. And it says he has put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church. Now, people, most countries in the East, and I'm not sure about your culture here, but I do know that in India and Pakistan, where I spend a lot of time, that the greatest insult you could give a person was to take off your shoe and hit them with it. You remember President George W. Bush was in Iraq several years ago, and he was giving a conference, a press conference, and an Arab man, an Iraqi man, took off his shoe and threw it at the president. To Westerners, that just meant that he was trying to show his displeasure. But an Easterner understood this was the highest insult that he could give to a president. But the Bible said, the Lord, through his power, has put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 2, Paul said, wherein time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Satan, as the prince of the power of the air, has covered the earth in darkness. He has made it almost impenetrable. And the people of this world have had their eyes blinded, so they cannot see clearly where they go. They are stumbling in darkness. They tell that there is an underground river here on this island, and some of you have perhaps been there already. And when the guide turns off the light, you said you cannot see anything at all. You can almost probably feel the darkness. And that's what Satan, as the prince of darkness, has done to the earth. He has totally engulfed it in darkness. People cannot see where they're going. But when Jesus came down from earth, came down to earth from heaven, he penetrated the darkness because he is the light of the world. He made a pathway from heaven down to earth, and now light is in the earth because Jesus is the light of the world. Wherever he walked on the earth, he took light. Where people lived in darkness because of their sin, he said, rise up and walk. Your sins are forgiven. Where people were bound by sickness and by evil spirits, he came as light and they were delivered. There was power in his hand. He was light walking through the earth. But at the end of 33 years, evil hands took and crucified him on a cross. They buried him in the tomb. And then it seemed that was over until one day, the third day, he came out of the tomb, rose, and began to walk. And he met with his disciples. He met with different ones on that last period of his life before he ascended into heaven. But you see, he was the one who brought down light from heaven when he came down to earth. But that meant only those who came from heaven could still impact the earth. After his death, burial, and resurrection, the Bible tells us that he ascended back into heaven. This meant that he now had made a two-way highway. Not only could someone come down from heaven, but others could go up to heaven. The pathway had been enlarged and made possible for us as believers now to also go there. When he ascended into heaven, he ascended to the right hand of power, far above all principalities and powers, all might, everything that has been named in this world and in the world which is to come. He is far above that because he ascended into heaven. Praise God. He sits there in a position of power. In John chapter 3 and verse 13, it says, "And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven." The Amplified Bible put it this way, "No man or no one has gone up into heaven, but there is one who came down from heaven, the Son of Man himself, whose home is in heaven." He was the one who made the way through the darkness. He was the one who cut bright light into that dark, impenetrable darkness. He came and he walked on the earth. But after his resurrection, he ascended back into heaven, making that two-way highway. In Ephesians chapter 2, in verse 4, it says, "But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace are you saved, and hath raised us up together and made us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." I want you to get the picture here now. Satan thought he had destroyed man's relationship with God. He thought he had defeated the plan of God. And he even had Jesus, the culmination of that plan, crucified, and he thought, "I've won." But actually, the resurrection of Jesus brought new life into the earth. For the first time, sin had been defeated. But it was not enough for Jesus just to resurrect. He also had to ascend. And when he ascended, that's when he ascended into a position of power and authority. Now Paul is saying, we who were dead in trespasses and sins, we who had no hope, we who seemed to have been lost for eternity, have now been raised up together through the new birth, through repentance of our sins. Our old life is gone. But then we are buried with Christ in baptism in the name of Jesus. That old life is put under. And then it says that we are raised to walk in newness of life through the Spirit, through the Holy Ghost. But I say, just as for Jesus, that was not enough to have power. He ascended into heaven, sitting at the right hand of power, now far above all principality and powers and names and might and whatever there is that has power and authority in this world. He sits far above it, but now because he made a two-way road, we also can ascend into heaven, and we sit with him in heavenly places. There is no political power. There is no financial power. There is no military power. There is no kind of power, whether it's fame or whatever it is, that comes close to the power that the believer has. We now sit far above all principalities and power and might and every name that will be named in this world and in the world which is to come. When I pray against evil spirits, when I pray spiritual warfare, I don't look at the devil as being up here or here. I'm looking for him somewhere way down there,
because I sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He has given to his church authority in this world today. You have the greatest authority, more than the President of the United States. You don't have just a little power. You have great power, exceeding power. And every other power is so far beneath you, you need a telescope to see it. So he has raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The new birth was for redemption. But the ascension is for warfare and authority. We stop many times at the resurrection, but Jesus didn't stay here. He went back into his place of authority. And I believe that he wants the church to arise in this hour, understanding their authority and power that we have to rule over this world that is filled with darkness. Praise God. I have seen to a small extent how the Lord can do that. I mentioned a little bit yesterday about some of our experience in Pakistan, but in the span of about 10 years, we saw almost 50,000 people baptized in the Holy Ghost in a nation that is 97% Islamic. I believe that the Lord's got greater things for that nation. I believe he's got greater things for the world. You folks here have seen one of the greatest revivals that has ever happened. But that's just the beginning. Praise God. He's going to take and multiply what you have. He's going to use you because you have the power. You have the authority. And wherever you go in his name. You're not going just as a weakling to represent the kingdom of God. But you're going with power, with authority, with anointing. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I suppose many of us arriving here came by airplane. Some of you maybe live here and others came by boat, I don't know. But many of us came by plane. And I'm sure that you have sat on an airplane on the tarmac where the rain was coming down and the clouds were dark and it didn't look very happy. And suddenly the plane began to move down the runway and you could feel the thrust of the engines as your seat you go back into your seat. You feel the power there and then the plane begins to lift into the atmosphere. And because there are many clouds, it begins to shake and there is turbulence. You can feel the shaking. But as you continue to ascend, maybe at times you wonder if you're going to make it. But as you continue to ascend, finally you break through the clouds. And it's glorious sunshine. Everything is clear and beautiful. Praise God. When we ascend into that position of authority, there may be some turbulence. You're not going to have power unless you have to fight the enemy. You remember when the seven sons of Sceva tried to cast out the evil spirit from an individual, and the devil said, well, they said, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches to come out. The devil said, well, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who in the world are you? The reason why those devils knew Jesus and Paul was because they'd come into conflict with them and understood that they were already defeated. But they said, we don't see that in you. The reason why a lot of believers today don't have power is because they're still living in the world with the mindset of the world. Israel could not gain the promised land unless they went in and took it. They had to defeat Ai
and they had to defeat other cities, Jericho. They had to go in and claim the promise. If you want to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, the promise is there for you. If you've got the Holy Ghost, if you've been baptized in Jesus' name, the promise is yours. You can rise in ascension to a place of power and authority. But to get there, you're going to go through some turbulence. You're going to have to do some battling. And I don't want to discourage you, but I'm 65 now. I got the Holy Ghost 56 years ago, and I'm still battling. Oh, but we have a lot of victories to look back on, too. Because when you sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, everything is below. Hallelujah. Everything is below. You don't have to even lift up your head anymore because everything is beneath your feet. Praise God. Praise God. So like Israel had to go in and claim the promised land, if we're going to sit in a position of authority, it is available for us, but we will have to go after it. We will have to pursue it. Now I want to show you for a few minutes, if you're going to do spiritual battle, you have to know who you're fighting against and the system that he has. And many years ago, I heard Brother Billy Cole talk a little bit about this, and so it had an impact on me, but I also began to do some study of my own through the years, and I've come to understand the spiritual alignment of forces around the world and how they can be defeated. In the book of Daniel chapter 10 and verse 13, Daniel chapter 10 and verse 13, the angel came to Daniel who had been praying and asking God to forgive the sin of his people. And an angel came to him and said in verse 13, "But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia." Over every nation, there is a prince, a spiritual authority that controls that area or territory. Satan is the prince of the power of the air. He controls the world. But under him are princes in different areas. And here the angel told Daniel that the prince of the kingdom of Persia, and that prince is very active today. It's not called Persia today, it's called Iran. But he's still very, very active. And it said that the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But Michael, one of the chief princes, one of God's chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. During the time of Daniel, there were four kings in Persia, Cyrus and Darius and a couple of more. But those men ruled during his lifetime. There were others who came afterwards. But all of them, as kings, were impacted by the spirit or the prince of Persia. There was a spirit that impacted the leadership of that nation. And he said, "There I remained with the kings of Persia." In other words, the kings came and went, but that spirit prince still was there impacting that nation. The New Living Translation puts it this way: "For 21 days, the spirit prince of the kingdom of Persia blocked my way. Then Michael, one of the archangels, came to help me, and I left him there with the spirit prince of the kingdom of Persia." So what happens is, there are spirits that control nations. There are spirits that control provinces or states. There are spirits that control cities. And whatever the political setup in a particular nation is, those areas are similar in the spirit realm. There are spirits that influence people at every level of government. Last night you had the mayor of your city, this city, come here, and he gave us a wonderful explanation of how this city became known as the dwelling of the city of God. This is the city of God. He explained that to us, that he presented a resolution to the council. Today he is the mayor. I believe when the church prays for their political leaders, it helps them to overcome the spiritual prince that's coming against them to cause things to go wrong in that city or that nation. It's important to pray for our political leaders, that God would give them wisdom, that they would come under the right influence so that they would make decisions that would enable the church to preach the gospel freely. I believe we can do that. I believe that God gives us the authority. I remember shortly after we moved from Karachi, where we'd spent most of our first 8 years, up to the city of Islamabad, which is the capital in Pakistan. And I walk every morning. While I'm walking, I'm praying. And I used to walk by a mosque that was a madrasa or a religious school. And as I would walk by there, I would pray, Lord, deliver these little boys. Don't let their minds be poisoned. Let them be influenced with the right spirit. I believe that we can impact people. We can impact nations. I believe that the Lord moved us to the capital city because he knew there was going to be a great spiritual battle, and political authority flows down from there. We had to be at the seat of power. So we faced different things over the years, but the Lord did give us great victory. When you go to a new city, and I mentioned this the other day, if you'll pray, Lord, show me the direction, the area of the city that I need to settle first, the area that's ready to receive the gospel, the area that's ready to and open to hear our message. Take me to that area first. Lead me to the people that we can reach best of all. And so God will give you direction and guidance for those areas. Now in Daniel chapter 12 and verse 1, it says, and at that time Michael shall stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of my people. In a parliament, I'm from Canada, so I'm using that example. In a parliament, we have the governing party and then the opposition parties. The governing party sits on one side and the opposition sits on the other. The governing party has its cabinet, but there is what they call a shadow cabinet on the other side. The opposition has people representing finance and global affairs and different positions, and they are the ones that will challenge the government on those areas. That's what happens in the spiritual realm. There is a prince from this world on one side, but there's also a prince for the children of God on the other side. And when we pray, we help determine who's going to win. We have that power and authority. And so we need to pray that God would give us victory in those areas. So Michael was the prince for the children of God, or the people of God, the children of Israel. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 10, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. I said yesterday the princes of this world didn't know what they were doing, or they would never have crucified the Lord of glory. But here he said, the principalities and powers in heavenly places. In Ephesians 3 and 10 it says, God's purpose, in the New Living Translation, God's purpose in all this was to use the church to display his wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. God uses the princes of this world, or uses the church rather, to display his wisdom, which we read about in the first chapter of Ephesus. He shows us the wisdom of what needs to be happening in the world. It was hidden from the beginning, but now it has been revealed to us. Now we understand what needs to be done. We have clarity of mind. We can go into nations and cities and we can defeat the powers that control that area so that people can be set free. Can I explain it this way? The difference between just going in and doing it the way any other group would do it and doing it through the Spirit is the difference between line fishing and net fishing. You may catch one or two here or there if you do it through traditional methods. But if you will go in the Spirit, if you will go with the anointing of the Holy Ghost, you can tear down spiritual strongholds. And when you tear down those spiritual strongholds, suddenly things begin to happen. Anybody who wants to get saved can get saved. Up until that point, their eyes have been blinded. Oh, but when we step forth with power and authority and have taken control over the spirit realm of that city or nation, and when we have subdued that spirit, then anybody who wants to come to the Lord can. And you can see people come in the not only tens and the 20s and the hundreds, but the thousands and even in the millions. Somebody's broken through here in the Philippines. But unless you continue to battle, unless you continue to pray, you won't be able to see this sweep the entire nation. But I believe God's going to help you do that. I want you to understand where you are sitting today. You are sitting in a place of spiritual authority. You're sitting in a place, not of political power, but of spiritual power. And there is no greater power. Praise God. Because the Spirit which created the heavens and the earth dwells in you. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's what we wrestle against. We're not wrestling through politics. We're not wrestling through money. We're not wrestling through natural means. If you want to use money to get your purpose, you're going to be defeated. If you're going to use politics to get your goal, you're going to be defeated ultimately. But I want you to know, if you sit in a power of spiritual authority, God will raise you up. You're going to be able to overcome the enemy. He's going to be brought down in the name of Jesus. Colossians 2:15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. Said that the Lord humiliated them because they are under his feet. He was trampling all over them. He absolutely humiliated those powers and principalities. We're not there just to tie them up a little bit. We're there to humiliate them. Hallelujah. They've lied to people all their lives and said, you can't make it. But the Lord said, oh, yes, you can. I'm sending my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In Matthew chapter 12 and verse 28, Jesus said that if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house? When you go into a new territory, you've got to bind the strong man before you can spoil his house. You may sneak in quietly and grab a thing or two, but you're not going to really be able to spoil his house until he's bound. You've got to go in there with a confidence that you have victory and that you have authority. I'll just give you an illustration of how God gave us a great breakthrough in the nation of Pakistan. And I trust that you will understand it. It's a personal experience. It's something that my wife and I lived through, as did many other people. In May of year 2001, I was driving in my car somewhere in the town, maybe going to the bank, doing some errands. I received a call from the pastor in that city, Brother Khalid Pervez. He's now our general superintendent. He took my place when I left. And he called me and he said, "Brother Shom, I would like you to come to the church and help us pray. Brother Kasser, his daughter is bound by an evil spirit, and we need you to help us pray." And Brother Kasser was an elder in his church. When he came to the Lord, his family did not come with him. But he was a great and powerful man in the spirit. He knew how to pray. He worked in a government office. Many times he would pray for his fellow co-workers that they would be healed of blindness and different things. He prayed for a Muslim priest, and that man was healed instantly from blindness. There were many miracles that he saw happen, and he knew how to pray. But Brother Collett, the pastor, said Brother Kasser's eldest daughter has been possessed of evil spirits. Would you come and help us pray? And so I went to the church. May is the hottest time of year in Pakistan. It was close to 50 degrees centigrade, Celsius, whatever you used to call that, about 120 degrees Fahrenheit. And inside it gets hotter than that because most places don't have air conditioning and the fan just blows hot air. But we went in and began to pray, and I could immediately see that there was an issue here. Small spirits began to come out very quickly. I was born and raised in India. My parents went there as missionaries in 1949, and I was born a couple years later. And I had seen many occasions, because in India, the Hindus claim to have 33 million gods, and there are many spirits in that nation. You can feel their effect on people's lives. Almost every service that we had, people would come that were devil-possessed. They would try to disrupt the meeting. And I had seen my father deal with that. And so I had some experience. I had some understanding on it. And I began to rebuke these different spirits. And many of them came out instantly. And then suddenly it seemed like we hit a stone wall. We couldn't make any further advance. And so we continued to pray through the day. Brother Khalid contacted some of his church members, and they came and started to pray. To make a long story short, for the next 3 weeks, we had a continual prayer and fasting meeting going on, praying for this young lady. There were times when she would crawl like a snake. There were times when she would become very flirtatious. She didn't at that time speak much English, but she would speak very clearly to us when we spoke. And when people who had been praying with her for a couple of hours would go into the pastor's apartment just behind through the door and refresh themselves, if they took a rest or whatever they did, when they came out, she would tell them, I know what you were doing back there. And she would tell them. We knew that we were dealing with very strong spirits. And so I asked Brother Kasser, or Brother Kasser, I said, "How is it this has happened?" And he said, "Well, for the last year, I have been praying against three strong spirits. One was the spirit of Antichrist, the second one the spirit of the Prince of Pakistan, and the third one is the Prince of Islam. And I don't recommend anybody try that alone. I think it's good to go in unity. If you have to do it alone, you do it. But if you can take people with you, it's a whole lot better." And anyway, he had been doing that, and the enemy reacted by causing a young Muslim man to become interested in his daughter at university. And she refused his advances, so he went to a witch doctor and had a curse put upon her. And as a result, she had become possessed. As we prayed for her, it seemed like we were having a difficult time making a breakthrough. And so Sister Shom sent some emails out. Different people, Brother Billy Cole, Brother Stone King, others from around the world started writing us, saying they were praying, giving us some suggestions what we needed to do. And so we continued to pray. Somewhere around a week and a half into this session, I was praying one day with this girl. And I don't normally ask the spirits their name because I don't want to dignify them with that kind of authority. But I understood we were fighting something a little bit different this time. And so I commanded those spirits to give their name. And a voice spoke out. There was a man's voice out of this young lady. Said, "I am the Prince of Pakistan." And another one said, "I am the Prince of Islam." And another one said, "I am the spirit of Antichrist." All right. And then the Holy Ghost hit me. You see, we sit in heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers. Praise God. The Holy Ghost moved upon me, and I said, "Satan, you think that you've got the church tied up here and that we can't evangelize because you've got us tied up. But I've got news for you. You can only be in one place at a time. And I'm releasing the blood of Jesus to flow through this nation, north to south, east to west, and there's not a thing you can do about it." Oh, the Holy Ghost is in this place right now. Just read out and touch him. He comes to the Lord of the Hosea. He comes to the Lord of the Hosea. He comes to the Lord of the Hosea. Hallelujah. 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 We went on for another 6 or 7 days, and then Sister Sean was working at the International American School to help pay for our children's education. I went to pick her up one day. I left the church and went to pick her up, and we were just going to go home and have a shower, have a bite to eat, and then go back to the church and pray. By this time, we were both exhausted. She looked at me and she said, "Alan, we've got to pray and ask the Lord to send warrior angels to come and help us. We can't fight this thing by ourselves." And so we had our meal or shower. We came back to the church. It was about 8 o'clock at night. By this time, many of the church people had gathered to pray. On one side of the platform was the young girl who was devil-possessed. On the other side of the platform were about 15 to 20 of our men that were filled with the Holy Ghost and praying in the Spirit. And for 4 hours, we interceded and prayed. And then at the stroke of midnight, all of a sudden, this young girl looked up into the corner just above those men's head. Begin a very flirtatious kind of look, gave a very flirtatious kind of look, as though there was somebody there that looked very attractive. And then a look of sheer terror struck her face. She went down and began to crawl back into the corner. When Sister Strom and I saw that, we looked at each other and said, "The angels have arrived." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. None of those men had their eyes open. They didn't see what was going on. But together, instantly, they grabbed hands and began to dance around in a circle and rejoice. And Pakistanis don't worship that way. Something had broken in the spirit. The spirits left that young lady instantly at that moment. Just a few weeks later, we went to the city of Karachi, a city of about 24 million people. But we were having a crusade there. Brother Doug Kleinitz was coming. It was the year of the Fall of the Fire Crusades. And Brother Doug Kleinitz was there to preach it. But I felt impressed in the Holy Ghost to ask our intercessors in Islamabad to go down and help us pray. I said, "I'll pay your way there. I'll pay your food and your hotel, but I want you to go and help us to pray." And every day during the day, they would be praying. At night, we had a tent set up at the side of the large ground where we were having our meeting, and they would be praying in there. On the last day, Brother Kleinitz found out that they were praying, and he said, "I'd like to meet with them." So he went over to their hotel room, talked a little bit, prayed. For the next 4 hours, God moved mightily into that place. At the conclusion of that meeting, Brother Kleinen said to them, when I pray the prayer of faith tonight, I'm asking you to come on, join me on the platform. These are regular saints in the church. These were not famous evangelists or mighty men of God that we would call mighty men of God. They were just saints in the church. But he said, you have broken through something in the spirit, and I want you to come, and when I pray the prayer of faith, I want you to join me and extend your hand over that crowd. There were about 25,000 people there. And so he called them to the front as he finished his message. When he prayed and they extended their hands, the Holy Ghost fell in that place. In the next half hour, over 3,000 people were filled with the Holy Ghost for the first time. Everywhere we looked, people were getting out of wheelchairs. People were bringing their crutches to the front. Eyes that had never seen were suddenly being opened. The miraculous took place. And God did a mighty work in that city that night. A few weeks later, we started getting news reports that the radical press was writing that many Muslims had been converted in that crusade. They were trying to stir up people against, because it's against the law to convert a Muslim in Pakistan. And they were trying to stir up the people against the church, and they mentioned some of our names. And I was getting a little concerned, but then it hit the mainstream press. And I became very worried what was going to happen. And while that was happening, suddenly 9/11 happened. And the world has never been the same again. If you look at the Islamic world today, almost every one of their nations are in absolute turmoil. They've had the Arab Spring, the Afghan War, the Iraq War. Iran is kicking up its heels. Yemen, Libya, Tunisia, Egypt, Morocco, Syria, Lebanon. Anywhere you want to look in the Islamic world. In Pakistan, we've had over 60,000 people killed by suicide bombings alone since that time. There's been all kinds of chaos in the Islamic world. And I believe what happened was, as the church was praying and taking power over spiritual forces, the church around the world that was joining us who were in Pakistan, we were stirring up something so that people could understand what this spirit really is. That it might show itself the way that it really acts. And today there are literally thousands of Muslims around the world who are realizing that all their religion is killing and hatred. But we serve the Prince of Peace. We serve one who can save people from their soul, from their sins. Praise God. The Lord has given the church victory. And I believe if we'll continue to pray, we can sit in places of authority. We can command what happens in this world. Hallelujah. I want you to know you are not a defeated child of God. God has left the church here to fulfill a commission. And I believe we are fully capable of undertaking that commission and fulfilling it. Praise God. Praise God. Let me give you some scriptures now in closing. If you'll take and read these to the devil every time he comes against you, you can remind him of where he really is. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15 in the Garden of Eden, after Adam and Eve had eaten of the fruit of the tree of knowledge and good and evil, the Bible says that God came down. He cursed the man and the woman, and then he cursed the serpent, who was Satan. And in Genesis 3 and 15, and he said, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. There's going to be a constant battle. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. For 2,000 years, it looked like the devil was winning. He kept striking the heel of God's people. He kept poisoning God's people. But when Jesus came to the earth, he lived a sinless life, and when he died on the cross, he shed perfect sinless blood that was able to cleanse from any sin. And so somebody who had lived for the devil for 80 years, done all kinds of wicked things, now in a moment's time could call upon the name of Jesus, and all that 80 years of the devil's work was gone in an instant. But he said that your head is going to bruise his heel, but his heel is going to bruise your head. The head is really the center of the human body. It's not down here, that's where our heart is, but really it's the head that controls and directs. A person can live if they have their foot amputated. It makes things difficult, but you can survive. But if you lose your head, you're done. And I've got good news for you today. The devil's lost his head. Jesus trampled him underneath. Now, because we sit in heavenly places, every time he tries to pop up, we put him down again. Every time it looks like he's going to rear up and do some damage, we come against him in the name of Jesus and put him back in his place. I'm saying this carefully. I understand his power. I've faced him many times. And I say this with a great deal of humility, but in the position and the situations that I've been in, I face Satan face to face. But I am not afraid of him. I respect his power, but he also has to respect my power. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And the Lord has given the church authority over Satan to bruise his head. In Psalm 91, verse 13. Satan quoted this to Jesus in the wilderness after he had been fasting, but this is actually a misquote because it wasn't meant for Jesus. It talked about you'll have long life and other things that did not relate to Jesus. Satan was just pulling scriptures out of context because he is a liar and one of deceit. But this scripture in Psalm 91 and verse 13 says, "Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder." The devil, as a roaring lion, goes about seeking whom he may devour. Ah, but the Bible says he's under our feet. You shall tread upon the lion and the adder, which is a snake, and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. The spirit that rules the nation of China, the largest nation in the world, is a dragon. And I've got news for that spirit, that God is raising up an army that's going to defeat that spirit. And the greatest revival that will happen in the world may happen in the nation of China, the most populated country. I think the Lord is enlisting prayer warriors today. People who are going to pursue that higher calling. That place where they can sit in a position of authority. Where they can overcome the power of the enemy. Where they can trample him underfoot. He said, you shall tread upon him. A tread is not just a light touch. I wonder what that's going to be. All the serpents and the scorpions, whatever they are, he's going to give us victory. Because in Luke 10 and 19, Jesus said to his disciples, behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over, how much of the power of the enemy? All the power of the enemy. Because all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named is far beneath us. And he said, nothing shall by any means hurt you. I know there's a time when the church faces persecution. God allows that, and the church always grows under persecution. But there are also times when the famine strikes where the land of Goshen is spared. There are times when God sets aside his people for a special work in a special time and allows them to see things happen that you can't imagine. We had about 15 major crusades in a span of 5 years. In every case, there were suicide bombings going on around us. One of the former prime ministers was assassinated. All of these things would happen just right around our meeting. But it was like we were living in an island by ourselves, totally oblivious to what was going on, because the Lord had put a hedge around his church. And out of our 167,000 believers, not one of them was affected. You see, we're sitting high above all principalities and powers. God has given to us the victory today, and nothing shall by any means hurt you until you've completed the will of God. They tried to kill Paul how many times? Until at the end, when he finished his course, the Lord said, okay, now you can come home. But until that time, he went down in a basket. They tried to stone him. He got shipwrecked. There was all kinds of things happened. The devil did everything he could to destroy Paul, but he just kept going and opening more doors. Hallelujah. He kept breaking open new strongholds because the Lord was with him. And nothing shall by any means harm you.